Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. This panel has an official title, but I'm just going to refer to it as the Scandal Panel. glad you could all be here. Very briefly, just want to run over a couple of ground rules for the benefit of our panelists and the audience. It's all on the record, and I like to run panels by taking questions from the audience during the conversation. I think it keeps it lively, makes sure that the questions are to the point. So I want you to encourage you to raise your hands when you want to ask a follow-up question, you want to introduce a new related topic. By all means, put your hand in the air and we'll try to get to you. It almost goes without saying that there are questions I will not be able to get to, so I hope you understand. And I, in all likelihood, if there's plenty of interest in the audience, will not go to you more than once. But do participate. This is a participatory affair, and I'd love to hear your thoughts, as would our panelists. I was reminded last night that we wouldn't be here if it weren't for a crisis, one that brought down Drexel almost 25 years ago. And Los Angeles has kindly served up a new scandal for us with the Clippers. I'm sure that'll come up in our conversation today. Here today, as you probably know if you've had a chance to look at their bios, is an ideal group of people to discuss crisis management and communication. In other words, what to do if you're really screwed. To my far right is Susan Gilchrist. She is the CEO of the Brunswick Group, and I can say from personal experience that Brunswick is one of the most effective corporate PR firms. Sitting right beside me here is Frank Luntz. He's the CEO of Luntz Global Partners, one of the country's most influential and foremost pollsters. To my left is Judy Smith, a crisis management expert, notable, as you may know, for advising Monica Lewinsky, and also for being the inspiration and the co-executive producer of the hit TV show Scandal. And to my far left is Miles Nadal. He's chairman and CEO of MDC Partners. It's the sixth largest marketing and advertising firm in the world, with more than 50 agencies in its network. So without further ado, we should begin. I might add that every journalist like myself knows good PR is the bane of all good stories. That's why these people make such a good living. I'd like to start our conversation by asking our panelists about the challenges of managing crises in the 21st century. The crisis part, it seems to me, hasn't changed much. If you get caught in flagrante delicto, what do? You calmly put your pants back on, and then you pick up the phone and call one of these people. But what happens then? So I'd like to know, how much different is managing a crisis today in a world of Twitter and TMZ? Susan, how about we begin with you?
Okay. Well, I think it's a very good question, because I think a lot has changed. I think three things have changed in terms of handling a crisis. Particularly for companies. The first is the financial crisis created huge waves. There were big financial impacts, but there were big human impacts too. And the whole social fabric was really shaken. And as a result, people are angry and they don't have trust. Second is technology. As you said at the top, Eric, technology has profoundly changed the nature of crisis. There are 22 billion likes and shares on Facebook every day. There are more mobile phones than people on the planet. So the world is hyper-connected. Everyone has an opinion and a way to express it. And I think those two things have led to the third thing, which is there's been this profound shift in public attitudes. Politicians know society is angry, so they don't want to look soft on big business. Regulators are very sensitive to the fact that they have been accused of being asleep at the wheel during the downturn, and therefore they're trying to be very aggressive now. And then the general public is very anti-authority. They know they can bring people down, and they want to bring people down. I think Mark Benioff of Salesforce had a great expression for it. He called it the corporate spring. So when crisis happens, the same events happen, but the actual backdrop and the environment you're dealing with is faster, it's global, it's more aggressive, and it's more intense. So it feels very different.
I agree with what Susan said. I think we can underestimate the impact of technology and the speed at which issues become rampant and dramatic. We interviewed CEOs of companies that went through crises. 63% of them said, we were well trained for media relations, we were not trained for crisis communications. And I think the issue is not just about getting ahead of the facts and information to expel any misunderstandings and to get ahead of the practical issue, it's the emotional issues. I think there's a greater sensitivity about the human impact that is really now critical. And I think, as Susan articulated, there are many reasons why people are much more sensitive, that government is more sensitive. I think the third thing that's really critical is you need to have the entire leadership on board. And the biggest issue is you need to have a culture of trust and candor where people are allowed to bring bad news. Most of the companies that we have talked to have said, we didn't have a culture that really rewarded people for honesty and open communication. And usually, as a result of that, what happens is people keep bad news under the carpet, and then it comes out, and then you're trying to play catch-up baseball, and that's the worst situation you could be in.
I would add just something that just on leadership. I think it's very different now, because it is not just that you need CEO leadership in a crisis to get things done. It is required, but I also think that the public, the regulators, and the media to some extent, people now demand it, because social media always creates such a frenzy about things. Before, there would be conversation about when you would roll a CEO out, and you would wait and maybe you take a different tack, but it is very different now. It's a totally different climate.
I wanted to ask you in particular a follow-up question, Judy.
Sure.
People often muse about what it would be like to cover the Kennedy White House in the 2010s with all the technology available to us and the amount of scrutiny that the president is under.
But you worked in the George H.W. Bush White House.
Yeah, did.
How much more challenging? Let's take the White House, for example. Mm-hmm. How much more challenging is it to manage, at the very least, communications, but at the very worst, a scandal? We haven't seen a bona fide scandal in the Obama White House yet. How much more difficult would it be today than it was back then?
Oh, at least 10 times more difficult. I mean, we had very nice things like, there's a lid. So that meant at 7 o'clock when we all went home that there was actually going to be no movement from the president until the next day. None of that even applies now, because things, it's so 24/7. I would also say as well, and I'm sure folks in the media would attest to this, it is so much more competition now. It's so much more competition. So I think that
it, competition among media.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. If I'm as on the other side on a crisis, I'm calling up and I might call a news outlet and say, why are you guys running with that, right? And I'm giving my point of view about what is factually incorrect with it. Oftentimes, one answer might be, we are citing another outlet and we had to go with it, because of timing. So I think, go ahead. Yeah.
No, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but just to reinforce what you said, the consumer has become the media as well.
Yes.
Because of social media, they see themselves as the media. So the media is not defined just by the traditional media. It's anyone who's got a black, any PDA, any access to communication, any ability to photograph or communicate, Twitter, whatever is required, to get that message out there. So we're learning that we learn as much about from our brand detractors as we do from our brand evangelists. And as a result of that, you never know where the crisis is going to come from. You never know where it's going to be exacerbated. And you never know what elements are going to put fuel in the fire.
Yeah. And I think the important thing about sort of everyday people in some ways becoming the media, but pushing the envelope, is that they can really force change. I'm thinking about when Bank of America had the situation with credit cards, and they were going to charge a little, extra, fee for taking out money. That was sort of an immediate social media response where people said, I don't really think that's a good idea. I don't want to pay additional money. And people heard it and immediately changed the position and policy. And that's an important tool that we didn't have years ago.
I just want to say one thing leading into Frank. Frank always said, it's not just important what you say, it's what people hear. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times in crises, people mistake issues with facts. And the emotional element and what people hear is the only thing that's relevant. Frank?
If you compare the two, politicians know how to speak, but they don't know how to listen. And corporate CEOs know how to listen, but they don't know how to speak. And you have to have both of them to be able to be successful. And you have to have people around them who are willing to look them straight in the eye and say, look, you cannot say this. Because as part of the new technology, it never goes away. Whatever people write is there for the public record forever. And I'm amazed that it reaches a crisis point before they start to even care about what's being said. You cannot erase it, you cannot eliminate it. And the staff around both politicians and corporate leaders want everything to be as even-keeled as possible. And I always get in trouble with this because, honestly, politicians say the dumbest shit. And their people will walk away saying, you know what, Senator, you were great. When the senator just said something that within 24 hours is going to blow him up and is going to cause weeks of bad publicity. There's no sense of looking towards the future. It's merely getting through the day. And that is the worst strategy. You have to be able to see a year, 2 years, 5 years ahead.
But this has always been the case. How does the proliferation of social media, for example, the blogosphere, the 24/7 news cycle and the instantaneousness of the internet change that?
Because they write things that aren't true. They make claims that aren't true, and then you end up having to defend something or explain something or clarify something that actually wasn't said. I do a lot of stuff in sports, and I've watched a number of labor actions, and players will accuse, and this has happened several times, players will accuse the owners of making a statement in a room that was never actually said. And then the owner has to say, well, I didn't say that players are treated like babies. Then the quote is, players are treated like babies.
It's a when did you stop beating your wife situation.
And it's almost impossible.
But it raises a very important, you're raising a very important issue here, which I think one of the other changes is that companies and politicians can create content in a way a few years ago they couldn't. And I think actually the market for content in a crisis is enormous. And actually, that's something that companies and individuals need to think about and how they use it. And I would argue, if we think about the recent crisis with the Malaysian Airlines flight, I actually think the Australian government has had, you know, a good crisis, if you can have such a thing in such a terrible, tragic accident. But that's because they've actually created a lot of content. They've had their press conference every day, but they've also provided a lot of information on the technology they're using to go down and look and search for the crash site. And actually creating content is something that every person in a crisis needs to think about, because you can't allow yourself to be disintermediated for all the reasons Frank is saying, because there is so much information out there that is actually wrong.
I think one of the things that's been articulated, and my friend Ed gave me this advice, he said, preparation prevents poor performance, the five P's. There was a six, but you're not allowed to say it. I think part of it is today you need to be constantly aware and prepared for crises when they before they happen. I think when a crisis happens, if you're playing, you know, if you've got a fire drill, you're usually in a very bad position. I think in the Malaysian Airlines situation, they had the benefit though of the entire world wanting to support it. Usually when there's a crisis, you're on your own. And in fact, the spotlight's on you and your competitors are happy. That famous expression, never tell people your problems, 80% of the people don't care and 20% of the people glad you have them. So a lot of the times you have, the spotlight's on you, and every single thing that you say or do is dissected, as Frank articulates. And what social media has done is then it allows people to put a spin on the information. And before, what was the expression? The truth gets halfway out the door. Sorry, the the falsehoods get halfway out the door before the truth has a chance to put their pants on. I mean, the reality is things get, you know, blown out of proportion. So I think you can't emphasize enough of everyday preparation for what is the art of the possible to happen. Because once you're, you know, under the microscope and it's a real fire or serious crises, a lot of the training gets thrown out the window just because you're not, it's hard to do.
I'm not sure I agree, completely agree with that, because right. I think, you know, I mean, I'm in an industry which survives on crisis management manuals, but I have to say, and it's, you know, heretical to say it, I don't really believe in them, because, you know, you have planned for 1,000 scenarios, and when a crisis happens, it's scenario 1,001. There is that great expression about it's the shark you don't see that gets you, and I think that's what it's like in a true crisis. And I actually think the thing that really matters in a crisis is leadership, not crisis management, because you can't control anything in this new world. But how your leadership thinks about it, how they put it in strategic context, how they respond with honesty, with clarity, in real time, that's what's going to make the difference.
I want CEO to stand up and actually not make a situation worse. Jamie Dimon putting his hand over the ABC News camera as he's getting into a car is death. I don't know what he's thinking. Why didn't his staff person said, sir, put your hand down. The CEO of BP, I hope none of these companies are here, because if they are, I'm dead. The CEO of BP saying that
we'd
wish...
We'd like BP, so.
He gets up there and he says he wish he was out sailing on his yacht. Right. He deserves everything. He deserves to pay you twice as much for being such an idiot. Lloyd Blankfein, I know there's Goldman people. There's Goldman people everywhere here. Lloyd Blankfein saying that we are God's gift.
Doing God's work.
God's work.
Right.
It's, do these people actually think before they speak to someone with a camera? This guy's from Bloomberg. There's a camera that's recording this. This is why we're on microphone. I don't understand why they behave this way. And it's more than just management. It's as though that when you become a leader, you suddenly think that the rules don't apply to yourself. And no one challenges them. And so they make so many mistakes.
But I think it's critical. I think, as Susan said, you need leaders with judgment, because at the end of the day, it's that at that moment, what do people say and what do they do? What's really critical, though, is, you know, there's a great expression, what's in it for the listener? If people asked the question before they spoke, oftentimes they would have a much greater result. And, you know, people just respond sometime, and it's only afterwards, when you listen to it, you go, wow, that I didn't. And if you ask, you know, we've had these responses where we had these, you know, focus groups afterwards, and you say to the CEO, what were you thinking? And it was like, well, I didn't really. I just, you know, I was upset. I was feeling emotional. I didn't think it would be. No one says I intended to be offensive. Everybody says I didn't think it would be misinterpreted.
But you know what, two things I want to go back to. One is, I think corporate leadership is important, but I think it's about the courage to exercise that leadership. Because so often in crisis, you don't see that. The other reason why it's critical is because you need to sort of shape your mind about thinking about a crisis like this, which is that the second that a crisis happens, that is really when you are setting the groundwork for really a sort of comeback or a rebranding. It starts right there, rebuilding a reputation after that. And it's what you do in the beginning, in the outset, that is going to determine how well a corporation is able to recover or not. It is absolutely critical.
It seems to me that we're talking about two different things. One is the things that are within your control, the degree to which you can exercise leadership, the degree to which you can say smart things as opposed to dumb things, and the things that appear to be beyond your control, like the media, the blogosphere. Let's take Twitter as an example. Is it truly impossible to exercise some control? Obviously, you can't stop people from posting what they're going to post, tweeting what they're going to tweet. But is there a way to undertake a proactive campaign to try to influence what people think about you and what people say about you on platforms like Twitter before it begins to happen? I know that some have tried. JP Morgan has already come up, but I do remember, and it might come up again in our conversation, but I remember when they were going to put Jimmy Lee, the vice chairman of J.P. Morgan, perhaps one of the most powerful bankers on Wall Street, on a tweet, like it was an Ask J.P. Morgan, you know, hashtag Ask JPM, you know, Ask Jimmy Anything kind of a thing, and it completely blew up, and they had to cancel it. And it seemed to me that that was an effort to try and control what people say and think about you on Twitter that proved to be a disastrous hashtag epic fail. Is that just totally foolhardy, or are those efforts
I think it's tone at the top. I mean, but it's a perpetual attitude toward taking your constituents and all of your, as I said, brand evangelists and brand attractors seriously 24/7. And when you have an issue, even if it's a minor issue about an experience, the more the organization responds on an ongoing basis to that, the more goodwill you establish in the community. And when you do have that, then there's a greater sensitivity and human compassion element toward when you have a serious crisis. But if you're trying to do that in the face of a serious crisis,
you can't. Right. No.
I think the fundamental thing is whatever you're doing in a crisis, you've got to look like you're part of the solution, not part of the problem. I mean, I think that's what the leadership really has got to do. And I think one of the trouble for a lot of the bankers during the financial crisis, when they were all up in front of Congress and parliamentary committees and things around the world, was they looked like part of the problem, not part of the answer. And I think that is fundamentally what you've got to prove.
They were trying to defend their position instead of recognizing that there's a problem or issue and here's some solutions to it.
And the social tensions they were causing.
Right.
Frank, we talked about, oh, there's a question. Excellent. Yes.
I think absolutely.
The way that you do it, you got to do four things. I made a mistake is the personal acknowledgement of it. I got it wrong. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? It's actually four steps. I made a mistake is acknowledgement of personal responsibility. I got it wrong allows you to define that mistake because you don't want someone else to say, oh, you apologize for this, but you really did this. I'm sorry, but you have to do the fourth part. Will you forgive me? Brings the audience, brings the consumers, brings people in. And I'm amazed that on a big scale, they never ask that final point, will you forgive me? Because for Americans here, we almost have to say yes. It's part of our culture. If you've been debased, if you've been humbled, Rupert Murdoch used an interesting phrase when he spoke at the British Commission. He said, this is the most humble day of my life. If you remember, that led in every newspaper, that led on every television network. The actual began with, Rupert Murdoch acknowledges today was the most humble day. That made him human. And the whole attitudes towards him changed by becoming human.
But also, the guy who threw the pie also changed the attitudes towards him on that day.
The other thing I would add to those points that Frank said, which I think is important, is when you go through those steps that he mentioned, a fifth one I think would be that apology and when you're asking for forgiveness has to be genuine. How many times have you seen anybody from politicians to CEOs to athletes go through those steps and you all sit and you watch it on television or you hear it and say, oh, well, God, that was kind of unbelievable. And you don't really believe what that person said.
So don't read it. How many of you are either CEOs who work relatively high up in a corporation? Raise your hands. Nobody here, practically. Don't let your CEO, don't let your senator, your congressman, your sports person read an apology. If they read an apology, everyone knows it's somebody else's words. If they read an apology, they're not looking you straight in the eye. If they read an apology, by definition, it is not sincere. And yet they still do it.
I was going to say, you know, I think what Frank articulates is really critical because there's got to be a feeling that there's a human compassion element and a sense of empathy for the issues and the implications of what's transpired in that crisis. There are two problems. One is most lawyers will say, you can't say that.
Right.
You can't apologize, you can't acknowledge any problems, you can't take responsibility. I mean, when you watch the GM crisis, and I know that she was just new on the position, but there was never an expression that said, you know, we are deeply, deeply hurt and sensitive to the losses And there was not a feel, it was just sort of very corporate in her delivery, which didn't give the families any feeling like you can empathize with the loss and what the emotional trauma we are going through. Number two is, there was never any acknowledgement that says, we are going to evaluate this, and if there is wrongdoing, we will go to whatever depths are necessary to eliminate from the organization any people who were not taking the responsibilities and the code of ethics and conduct of General Motors seriously. And, you know, there will be implications to that. She didn't say that. And I think people want to know that there is a responsibility and that change will be made and people will be held accountable.
I think it's the
problem about supporting the corporate mission versus holding people accountable. I mean, in politics, Frank, people get voted with their feet every day. I mean, you can run, but you can't hide. And, you know, there was obviously facts in the GM case that were very clear that they knew they had a problem, that there's no question that they didn't take action early enough and they allowed this to take place. There had to be some acknowledgement that we've made mistakes. We're going to do our inquiry. We're going to properly, you know, conduct the process. But at the end of the day, we will hold people accountable.
She wrote a letter to her employees. Actually, she called them that. Dear employee, I want to vote here. If she wrote, dear employee, dear colleague, which one is more personal? Which one would you prefer to receive from your CEO? Who would say employee? Who would say colleague? It's simple. Step number one. Step number two, and this is the part where you'll enjoy because I'm going to offend at least half a dozen people here. If she had said, I will take responsibility, I will accept what, and it took too long, but I will tell you that my most important job in life is not the CEO of this company. I have two teenage children, and my most important job in my life is a mom. And as a mom, I understand that when your children get into one of our cars, you want to know that that car will take them safely from point A to point B. And as a mom, I understand the pain that has been caused, and as a mom, I will solve it. Now, I had Norm O'Donnell on CBS rip me for saying this because, oh, that's sexist. Guess what? The next day, that's exactly what the CEO said. As a mom.
Does anybody here think that's sexist?
No, but you know what I think on this, though? It goes to a core point. I think it ties in what we're all saying, is that when a crisis, you have to address what people really want to hear. And inherent in what Frank said and what we're all saying is that in the GM case, to me, people want to know that safety is more important than profits. That's it. That's what they want to know. That's what they want to know. So what is the best way to communicate that in an authentic way that conveys that message?
We have a question in the front row. We've got a microphone for you.
Are they sorry? Are they actually sorry? Or are they just sorry that they got caught? And does it matter, or can it be genuine if they're not that sorry, if profits do come ahead of safety?
Well, ultimately, if profits come ahead of safety, the brand will fail in the marketplace because the consumer is very smart. The consumer really understands authenticity. And look, there are, you know, the best thing that you can do is bite the bullet early and pay for the recall up front before there are serious problems. Because whatever the cost would have been to just for the recall, it will pale in comparison to now the implications of the recall, all of the liability that's going to be paid for going forward. The interesting challenge that they face is, because they went through the Chapter 11, all of the liability actually happened previously, so they're technically not legally responsible. Question is, are they morally responsible, and what do they do with it? I think how GM handles that issue will have greater implication to the long-term success of GM than anything else that there is.
It's too late. It's absolutely too late. All the lawyer has to do, where are my lawyers in here? Get out. Do you know why Dick Cheney was an awesome vice president? He could have shot the dog, he could have shot the truck, he shot the lawyer. And he got the lawyer to apologize for being shot. Yeah. All the lawyer has to do for her, for GM on the stand, is to say, did you know about this last year in 2013. Did anyone in the company know in 2013? Yes, sir. Did they know about it in 2012? Did they know about it in 2011? Did they know about it in 2010? In 2009? And you continue to do this back. And I will tell you that after you ask that five times, and the lawyer, if they're smart, will go all the way through back to 2001, GM loses any civil settlement. There is no answer for a company who's known about this for 13 years, and they still continue to have recalls, it seems like every 2 weeks, because they haven't been honest. There is no way that you can fix that.
I think actually it's too early to tell. You know, I actually think if they, Miles, I think you've identified a very important point about the GM situation. If they act in the right way on that issue, I think there is a way to come back. I think one of the things about crises that are not based around one catastrophic event, but are based on a whole series of unfolding events, is it can take actually quite a long time before you know if you're getting to a better place or not. And you can lose a lot before you can actually get to a better position. So I think in the GM, I think it's actually a bit too early to tell.
But see, I think companies, though, in the rehabilitation part, have to be committed, which is a very hard thing, committed to that long road back, because it takes, you know, strategic, dedicated, integrated solutions to a problem. It's not an easy fix.
How do you know whether a company is committed to redemption?
I mean, I asked these guys to think about the rehabilitation of the Goldman Sachs name as part of this discussion, because it's kind of remarkable. If you think back to Goldman Sachs being the vampire squid in the pages of Rolling Stone magazine, Lloyd Blankfein was public enemy number one before Jamie Dimon became public enemy number one. And I remember, to your point and yours, Miles, about, and yours, Frank, about saying stupid things, the CFO, David Vinier, under questioning by Carl Levin, the Senate subcommittee hearing, being asked to defend or to explain how he felt about, I think it was the email describing the CDO, Timber Wolf, as quote unquote one shitty deal. And David's response was, I think it's really unfortunate that that was in an email. yet, here we are today in 2014, and I don't know if we could say that the Goldman Sachs brand has been restored 100%, but it's pretty darn close.
It hasn't been. If you do, we've done research into this, and without giving proprietary information, the Goldman Sachs brand is not respected for integrity. In fact, if you list the 20 top companies that are involved in this, Goldman Sachs comes in dead last. That is not why you hire Goldman. You hire Goldman because they will skirt the rules. You hire Goldman
because they will put profits before safety?
Because they will put profits before everything. And people hire Goldman because they're going to make money. And so they actually, they're fine with their reputation. It's an amazing,
it just doesn't matter.
I
actually think that they do care. If you look at the investment behind women's leadership issues, if you look at what they're doing in the communities around the world, you look at the amount of money that they donate, you look at the support that they give to their employees, they have had a corporate social responsibility and ethics desire to improve on an ongoing basis. I think you've seen more profile from Lloyd Blankfein.
You believe
since
that?
The,
you don't absolutely. Look, you know well, I, that the I, cynics, and you may be among them, Frank, and for all I know, Judy and Susan, you may be as well, look at 10,000 women and 10,000 small businesses and say, that's window dressing.
Look,
I think I
know this situation intimately. We do business with them. I know the guys individually. I will tell you, they're a much more humble and far less arrogant organization today than they used to be. Are they where they were before? I still think that they have the pick of the crop when it comes to young talent. Maybe a lot of that is because of the economic opportunity that exists. Look, Warren Buffett said in the height of the crisis that Goldman Sachs was the pinata poster boy for everything bad on Wall Street. You said something very astute. They were having all of these issues, and then Jamie Dimon was kind enough to take that away from them. I think they did play many roles, and that led them to get into compromised conflicts of interest. I think the world's changed. They just can't, first of all, regulatorily, they can't do what they used to be able to do. But I also think that they realize that they'll be under far greater scrutiny on everything that they do, so they need to walk a much tighter line. We did actually research for them about what their customers thought of them, and their customers are still very, very loyal. But you know, once you go through a crisis, do you ever get back to 100% of the reputation you had before? Probably takes years and years and years, if ever, that you're able to accomplish that.
But what I find interesting, though, is, to your point, how do you close that gap? So they've done these things, Goldman, and as you say, are making an effort. The numbers show something different, which is their point of view of perhaps of how they view themselves is very different than how they are actually viewed.
Frank,
so there's a disconnect there.
Does research ever show that you could get the brand equity back to the level before the crisis afterwards?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, you
Lee
can.
Iacocca did it for Chrysler.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mullally did it for Ford, so it can happen. I'm going to ask you, this is the 1% of the 1% in this room. How many of you specifically know of a specific Goldman Sachs social responsibility project? Raise your hands if you know of a Goldman Sachs social responsibility project.
Not the program, but an actual project.
Yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people in a room that seats 70. That's not success.
But picking up on Miles' point, I definitely think you can come back after crisis. And if you respond to the crisis in such a fundamental way on the reputational issues that Didi is describing, that you actually create a better company. And I think a great example of that actually is Nike, who I don't work with, so I have no vested interest in saying this. But when they had all their supply chain and labor crises in the 1990s, Phil Knight really stepped up to the plate. They totally transformed the way they monitored their supply chain. They actually changed the whole attitude towards sustainability in their company, created a new organizational structure. They now have sustainability partner with design and making new product. And I actually think they're a better company as a result. So how you use that crisis to create a better company is definitely an opportunity for you, but it takes years. That's taken Nike a decade.
Right.
And so the road back is, you know, I'm just doing a crisis with a company in China, and we're talking about the reputational rehabilitation program, and we're talking about it on a 5-year view. Yeah.
But it requires significant investment in transformation to be able to affect change on a dramatically different level, such that you change your go-to-market strategy. And it looks sincerely like you've used that as a catalyst to change.
Exactly.
It's got to be from the top.
Yeah. Nobody would invite a crisis upon himself or herself. But to the point that you just made about Nike and Phil Knight, can a crisis be a good thing? Like a forest fire, for example, right? Terrifying,
yes.
Destructive,
yes.
But
yes.
Ultimately necessary for the ecosystem.
Yeah. That's which doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And, you know, sometimes you do need to go through a crisis to rise to the next plateau. The companies that are intelligent to embrace the fundamentals of what happened, why did it happen, what are we responsible for, and how should we do things differently, I think they become a better company as a result of it.
There is always, I think, when you are in any crisis, the flip side of the crisis is the word really opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's always opportunity in a crisis. You just have to take advantage of it.
How do you know what the opportunity is?
Well, we can go back to Nike or any
corporate. I mean, in the midst of a crisis.
Yes.
Let's remember that it ain't fun.
No, right? No, that's exactly right. So let's just use a discrimination case just because it's coming to mind. So if Nike were to get sued for discrimination and it's a class action lawsuit and it, you know, stock goes down and it's awful, any company, and that sort of thing. It is an opportunity to take a good, strong look at the culture of the company, its employees, the kind of training programs we have. It's a huge opportunity to revamp something that clearly needs a good, strong look at and revamping.
We're only talking corporately, but we're not talking about personal crises.
I was going at some point. I wanted to get to this conversation. Is there a difference between a corporate crisis and a political crisis and a personal crisis? And I'm talking about a difference in nature, not a difference, obviously, in substance and fact. Right. And if there is, do you need to respond to those kinds of crises differently?
I think they're the same and different in this way. I think they're the same in the sense that they are sort of all victims of, you know, that 24-hour, never-stopping need information. And so that always happens. I think they're different in the sense that there are obviously different stakeholders and politicians. You know, you have voters and corporations, there are shareholders. But I also think that the nature of a crisis, the particular crisis, makes a difference, whether it's political or corporate. So I'm sure that we'll probably get to this. But the Clippers, you cannot pass a television or get in your car in the last few days without that being on. So, you know, that is really about race. You know, politics, when it involves sex, that's going to be on constantly. So it is also to the nature of the crisis, I think, that has can have a different effect to it.
I'm amazed at how little research is done in situations like this, and I'll use the Clippers as an example. Mm-hmm. And this is why some people don't want to give opinions about what should be done until they know what the public thinks first. Sterling does not issue his own apology. He does it through the Clippers organization, so there's no personalization to it. Second, that they don't know the veracity of the tape, but they've heard, they've seen it, and they don't challenge it. So this whole idea of having to wait 3 or 4 days before making a decision is absolutely ridiculous. Third is that you have to consider everyone involved in this process, which are the fans, the organization, the players, and the NBA. And right now, the players are turning. These players are fed up, and they're getting angrier and angrier. And I think that Adam Silver, the commissioner, waited too long to respond. It is clear from the tape. All of us in this room could listen to it and know what he had to say. It doesn't take that long to figure out that the guy is a jerk, that he's a disgusting jerk, and he really isn't fit to own a team. And finally, this is something that cannot be cleaned up. And so the issue with the personal is, what is the end game? What is the final decision made that closes this? I can't think of any other decision. Fans are going to boycott the team. The players,
sponsors are already
pulling
out.
Yeah.
And he actually will try for a little while to hold on to it. He's going to have 9,000 people at his arena unless he sells the team.
The problem is that, you know, besides being ignorant, he's exceedingly wealthy. So it's a bad combination because at the end of the day, he doesn't care. I mean, there was a way to deal with it where he could have been exceedingly apologetic. He could have said, I need help. I need medical help. I have an anger management problem.
Do you think there were people around him suggesting that?
Everybody's afraid. His wife's afraid of him. Why would anybody else?
Yeah.
If his wife's physically afraid of him, why?
Right. Afraid of him.
His ex-wife's afraid of him. I mean, he's just a monster. Mm-hmm. And so, no, nobody's going to stand up to him. Right. I mean, even Doc Rivers, who's a total gentleman, you know, took responsibility for the performance of the team as a result of that and said, it's my fault that they didn't play well. I didn't prepare them properly to deal with this crisis. Mm-hmm. I mean, look, when the great thing about America, as Frank articulates, it is exceedingly understanding. And, you know, you can get away with just about anything and say, I'm sorry, I have a problem. I'm going to get help. I am reenlisting myself into rehab for the 18th time. I appreciate your prayers. What I did was completely unacceptable. There's no implications for most individuals. It's not like corporations where you have other constituents, you have regulators, you have shareholders, etc. You know, like the Tiger Woods situation was a very interesting one. I mean, you know, if they had been more upfront, he got ahead of it. He was candid and upfront and said, look, I have a sexual addiction problem. I'm a normal male. I'm going into rehab. What I did was appalling. I'm ashamed and embarrassed. I appreciate everyone's support as I go through this process. It would have been fine, ultimately. I mean, it's pretty okay now. I mean, you know, you don't really think much about it. But the problem that celebrities have is they don't take it seriously and they don't listen. And do they have people around them? I mean, Lindsay Lohan's an example. I mean, you need people who will help you, but also you got to be receptive to listening. Frank, what percentage of the time are people getting advice inherently, do you think, and they're not listening?
80%. It's that high.
So if you're not prepared to listen, then you suffer the consequences. But the great thing about America is they want to
Susan, is that your experience with your clients? 80% don't listen to your advice?
No, I don't think it's true in the
corporate
world.
I'm not talking corporations.
No.
Talking
I think that's very different, but celebrities and
Lance
Armstrong.
What is the percentage in the corporate world?
I think it's a lot lower than that. I think that would, I don't know what to put a number on it, but it would be like really low. It might even be in single digits, actually.
Would you agree? I agree.
But so then in the corporate world, you've got a lawyer.
There's listening and there's listening and acting. And there's a difference. I mean, what percentage truly take all the implications as seriously as you express them and actually take action to the level that you think is necessary? I bet you it's less than half.
I don't know. I think actually, I think they do. And I think the biggest problem is something we touched on earlier is with the lawyers. You know, I've been in rooms where you've got a CEO, he's about to confront them, you know, talk to the media in a crisis situation, and the lawyer says, just before you do, if you say anything wrong, you're going to be criminally liable. Okay, off you go. And that does not produce, you know, a high quality, you know, sort of genuine conversation. So I think the problem for corporate leaders is being in the sort of this sort of nexus of differing kinds of advice, of people saying, be honest, empathize, put it out there, be a real human being and being compassionate, and the lawyer saying,
well, look, here's
nothing.
The only thing I would say. A lot of times people need to use business judgment. That it's very easy for the lawyer to say, if you walk in a room, you could be sued. Right. If you have any acknowledgement whatsoever, you're liable. That the CEO, whoever, has to take a business judgment and say, what's the probability that that will transpire? And what is the implications if I do, and what are the implications if I don't? 99% of the time, it's never that issue that becomes the suit or the facts for litigation, but the lack of responsiveness oftentimes is the perpetuation of the crisis and the devaluation of value of for shareholders long term.
And I want to say something in support of lawyers, for the lawyers in the room, which is that actually a lot of lawyers do understand there's not just legal risk, there's reputational risk, and good lawyers recognize reputational risk and advise on that basis.
I was going to say, I think on the corporate side, though, to your point, in addition to legal, I also think it's the financial balance as well. In addition to legal, all that advice and all the things that we say that one should do in a corporate crisis, they look at it through a legal backdrop, but also a financial one. You know, does it make good business sense?
The critical issue, though, is how do you conduct yourself from a corporate social responsibility perspective every day when things are good? Because at the end of the day, it's building that equity that's so critical that one day when you have an incident that is out of your control, how you deal with that and the implications, the level of understanding and compassion that your constituents will have will be very different if you are perceived as an organization of integrity, an organization of good ethics, Frank, right? You always talk about ethics, and an organization of true transparency and honesty.
I probably agree with 95% of what the panel has said. On the lawyer part, I just don't.
And you'll I tried, guys.
And you'll never know it, because you'll never hear it. Go back to 2008, particularly 2009, when companies were laying people off by the thousands, and in a few cases, tens of thousands. And in those cases where the general counsel ran the layoffs, human beings were destroyed. Companies that had never fired people before had to let people go because the economy froze up. And where it was being run out of the general counsel's office, people who'd been with these companies for 10, 15, 20 years were told they could not go back to their desks, or had people, armed guards, escort them out of the building because the general counsel wanted to make sure that there were no legal ramifications of what had happened. Mm-hmm. When it was run by human resources, compassion and caring and understanding for what it's like to lose a job when you're 40 or 50 years old and this is the job you've had for the last 20 years and your kids are dependent on you, human resources did it right because they were concerned about the human component. The lawyers could care less about communication. They just want to prevent the lawsuits, and people got damaged as a result.
I want to cover a couple of things before we run out of time. Did I miss a hand that went up in maybe the third row a few minutes ago? But there's one in the front row. Jamil. Hang on 1 second. We've got a microphone.
So my question is, you guys have had a ton of experience. Can you think of a recent case of a company or an individual in an extraordinarily difficult situation and all the things that they did right to extricate themselves from that?
Gosh, all the things right. That's
yeah,
hard.
You should put that all in there. That's why we're all struggling.
What was the recipe for success, in other words?
Well, I think I go back to the Nike example because I think they made a change in the 90s. They built on it ever since, and they actually went from corporate villain to a hero in sort of sustainability. And I think it's quite hard to beat everything they did. But they recognized a fundamental truth was if you operationalize your way into a crisis, you can't PR your way out of it. They fundamentally changed their business, and that's what was the secret of that journey.
Frank, can you think of one?
One of the dumbest self-inflicted crises, what Netflix did about 3 years ago, and it killed its share value because it did not understand social media. Here is a company born of the web and did not understand the power that existed, and it just turned people against them. Now that stock, and I'm watching to see if they do it again, but that stock now was at its all-time high. People made so much money out of it because it said after about 2 weeks, oh my God, boy, did we get this wrong. We really need to fix this. We heard you. We're going back. We're reversing our policies, and we're going to make the consumer experience the best that it has ever been. Whatever you can imagine, we're going to do it even better. And they went from vilified everywhere and a loss of a third of its value to being, once again, one of the most powerful companies in entertainment.
Facebook does a pretty good job of it. You know, they violate your public policy, privacy issue. Mark says, I'm sorry. Then they violate it again later on some other way. He says, I'm sorry. People still come, you know. So,
it's also
a complex relationship.
Codependent,
you know?
Maybe.
Right.
But look, I think you need to have an attempt to understand the issues of the constituents. The problem is that things usually gravitate to the lowest common denominator. So you're never going to keep everybody happy. In a great crisis communications activity, you know, what are you trying to satisfy? 90% of the people? 80% of the people? Frank, what do you think?
I want to satisfy the people who matter. If my company's lost one-third of its share value, then frankly, I'm focused on shareholders. If I've just laid off 5,000 people, I have to make sure that the other 55,000 people aren't destroyed, and so they take my company down as a result. And if I've just polluted a river, I better earn back the trust of the community first. There's a company in West Virginia that's going on right now, and I just, for the life of me, they should be paying you guys hundreds of thousands of dollars a month because it still smells, the water is still not safe, and it's now been not just weeks, but months.
Look, I think the biggest issue that I see with most leaders of organizations is these are people, as the leader, who are parents. They're children, they're community people, they're church, synagogue-going people, they have
not
family members. And yet they don't demonstrate the sensitivity on a humanity basis of the issues that people are facing in a crisis. That doesn't require a lot of strategy. It requires human empathy. And I think if you can demonstrate that with real sincerity, not because you're acting, because you really feel the issues and you reach out to the constituents that matter, I think it goes a long way to the implications. And so how people perform or behave or conduct themselves is as important as the strategy.
I wanted to ask one last question of the panel. Oh, there's a question in the crowd.
I was just wondering, how do you know?
Are you a lawyer?
I am a lawyer. Sorry.
And by the way, he's the only one who stood up to ask the question. Notice that.
So that's how you knew.
How do you know when you have a crisis? So you know, you're talking about getting out in front of it, going to your people, having the CEO or a person respond to it. But obviously, with 24/7 now, things are happening so fast and so often, you can't respond to everything. So how do you know when you have a crisis?
The one thing you know is you know you have an issue. How you deal with the issue becomes whether or not the issue becomes a major issue or a crisis. But you know for sure, and it's the smell test. It's like, here are the set of facts. If it was, we have a quote, like, what will it look like on the front page of the New York Times? You don't have to be a brain surgeon. I mean, I have no education. He's a doctor, at least. Actually, I am a doctor, but I bought mine. He actually earned his. But seriously, you know, if it appeared on the front page of the New York Times, what would it look like? What would your shareholders think? What would your employees think? What would the regulators think? What would your other constituents think?
21%. That's the number that I have over years. When a problem gets to 21% who are concerned about it, it has now reached the point when I have to deal with it. At 21%, it is now large enough that it can overtake everything that I have done and everything
and
I believe
destroy
in.
It.
It can destroy it. If it's below that, it can be dealt with, it can be managed, it can be quiet. At 21%, I have to respond.
Yeah. And I'll just add to that, I think it's about, is this in some way damaging my license to operate? Damaging my license to operate with my shareholders or communities or some other constituency. I think that's the sort of the test you're putting it through. And I love the 21% idea, but that's the test you're,
right.
you're
and
asking.
And is it going to affect your brand? I mean, you know that.
How do you know, Miles? I mean, one of the things that I wanted people to leave with is a sense of what happens if you don't anticipate and deal effectively with crises.
People might have been, look, well, I assume that you're here because you're interested, but is there, what's the
most
21% is a quantification?
How
do you measure the damage that a crisis can do?
Well, first of all, the most important thing is create a culture within the organization where issues can be openly, freely discussed without negative implications, that your leadership team is prepared to bring up to the top any issues, no matter how big or small, for them to be discussed so that you don't end up in a situation where you end up as a CEO going, why wouldn't someone tell me that? Why didn't I know about it 3 weeks ago? How did you bring it up to me now? And then it's a fire drill. So the first most important thing is create a culture where people are prepared to share negative information, where issues are brought forward, and then they're discussed. Is this an issue that has legs that could become a 21% problem? And deal with them as they come about, so that you have a lower probability of anything actually getting to the crisis standpoint. So it's an attitude of dealing with issues, not an attitude of dealing with crises. Because once something becomes a crisis, it's usually indicative because people didn't respond earlier enough and didn't take them seriously. Mm-hmm. And then what percentage of crises could have been reduced or eliminated had they been dealt with early on?
But see, that's why I think the smell test is important. If there is an issue or a problem that when you think about it, that you feel like you are affected by it, then you know that that's going to be a crisis or a problem. It's better to be safe than get to the point where it's a full-blown crisis and you didn't raise your hand about it.
Please ask a question for those of you who do research on a regular basis. And it's two words. One is trust and the other is integrity. Trust is how people feel towards you. Integrity is how they feel you act towards them. And you ask, it's a very simple question. Is this a company? Is this a person? Is this an organization I can trust? And do they act with integrity? And that should be measured every 3 months for the rest of your life. So that it's more, that I quantify it. Because that's how I measure whether there's a problem or not. And those are the two words that matter most.
Susan, we've
there's a gentleman in the back there.
You know what? Unfortunately, I was just going to say, if Susan, you had anything to add, please go ahead, because we have run out of time. And one of the nice things about the Milken Global Conference is that it runs on schedule. Susan, did you have any last words?
No, if you're in a crisis, I would say, look like you're part of the solution, don't look like you're part of the problem. That's my one piece of advice.
All but two of you have been sitting rapt for the past hour. I thank you so very much. The Scandal panel appreciates your attention, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the Milken Global Conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you.